Welcome to the Pursuit of the Perfect Race. I'm Coach Terry Wilson, and with each episode, I bring stories of athletes to you that share their experiences at races in order for you to learn how to have your perfect race. You'll hear stories from athletes of all ages, abilities, and races of all distances. So regardless of where you fit in, there's something in it for you. Thanks for spending some time with me today. Now let the pursuit begin.
Thank you. So I also live in a slightly hilly city, so my runs tend to have a little bit of elevation gain, slight compared to Bariloche, but, you know, it's better than training in Midland, Texas, that's for sure. Most of my bike workouts are indoor. The roads here are pretty dangerous, so I just people drive crazy, and the road quality is pretty bad. So my husband's working, and I just get my bike workouts done, and that helps on Swift. I was one of those people that hated the turbo trainer until I got the water picker with Swift, and now I actually don't hate it so much. So I would almost say I've been up to like 4 or 5 hours on the trainer. I'm not as crazy as Lionel Sanders, but I've done it a couple times.
So, if we look at your training overall, what was the most hours you trained in 1 week?
Oh man. It's hard. I'd say like 10 to 15.
Okay.
I work from home, so I'm pretty flexible. And again, like I've told you, I'm tired. I'm going to take a rest day if I have, things to catch up on. I'm going to do that. The thing is, I know I can finish it. I've done a couple of rounds to this point. I've got a full, I can finish it. That's always my fear. I think running is my weakest. Personally, I think it's my weakest. So I'm always so careful on the bike, even though I can go hard. My body just doesn't look
right. So as far as your training goes, were there any days where you just mentally did not want to train at all? Were you just like over it?
Yes, I totally have those days. And sometimes on those days, I find it in me to just go ahead and get something done, just do something. Other days, I'm like, screw it. And then, clearly, my body is telling me that I need rest, and I'm going to take it.
Okay. So,
I shoot for one rest day a week. Sometimes it turns into two. Sometimes it might be more. I'm trying to think back now. I know, the weekend before, the day see and do strength training all week before the race. I don't know if I'm going to call it a proper taper, but you know, no trouble in there.
So you see a great model, Ryan, and I know you live in Argentina where everything is metric. So are you still using imperial?
Oh, totally.
So you haven't made a switch yet?
Oh, God, no. I do a lot of math in my head. You know, I've always the specific distances, say, you know, marathon, half marathon, half Ironman, full Ironman, all, you know, in the metric system. So, because I have friends here, locals that I train with, so I have, they're like, will ask me how many kilometers are you doing today? And so occasionally they're like, oh, are you doing that on my phone using a converter? But no, I just can't make the switch.
Gosh, I don't know the metric system. I just wish I'd buy the world where you think this is everything.
Maybe imperial, right?
No, metric. Like everything, yes, everything's with public feeling. That's it.
You're so un American right now.
I don't know. Corporate Saturdays for a year and a half, and you run off on me.
Oh, gosh.
Yeah. So, you drove up there. What was your logic? Well, have you tried to find an Airbnb or the RBO or a hotel?
Yes, Airbnb. Hotel is probably your best bet, you know, for someone that doesn't live here. But we have too many dogs, and where I go, they go. So Airbnb is the best choice for us. The race hotel there, the Shasha, is incredible. I want to stay there one day, but I don't think they'll accept 260-pound dogs, so.
That dog's got good pains.
No. We have a street dog, 57, you know, boxer. Who knows what he is? And a golden doodle.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah. The golden doodle does a lot of my runs with me. She actually did a swim with me like last week, too.
In the pool?
In the river. We live by a river that comes down actually from the lake that I did the racing. It's really downstream. She was like sitting in the water next to me. She definitely tries to join.
Wow. So, with the lot you were used to get at Airbnb, how far away from the venue was this?
So, we say it was a little split up, but I'd say like the expo and finish area, it was probably about like a 10-minute drive, maybe less. I don't want to have too long with Airbnb, otherwise we would have been closer to town. Plus, you know, not all Airbnbs allow dogs, so the choices are even fewer. I would definitely recommend either staying at Shasha or closer in the city along in between. This is a split transition, so in between Shasha and the Race Expo, there's a ton of hotels and cabins for rent. And it's probably pretty cheap, but, you know, I procrastinated.
Gosh. So, the village itself, you've been to IRONMAN, you've been to a few different IRONMAN events, and you've volunteered a few times. How was this expo in relation to all of the other races you've seen?
It was about the same as I've never been to a huge expo at an IRONMAN event. So, I'm getting older, and Bariloche at this IRONMAN branded races. Hasn't been that big. I've done a couple, like, marathon and those expos were just enormous. So, nothing like things I do for tubes or, you know, CO2 cartridges, you can get them there at the expo. I would say your brands, in terms of like buying clothing, is a little limited to like sewing and
Steelfish.
I mean,
I'm not really big in America.
Yeah. See, Argentina has some pretty strict import laws and regulations, so it's really actually hard to get a hold of a lot of the brands that like you and I are familiar with down here. So whenever I go home, I'm always stocking up on the good stuff.
So is that big in Canada? Do you just have no great idea?
A lot of times either I get it when I go home, or I have, you know, some of the guys that work with my husband that rotate down here, we'll have it sent to their house and have them bring it to me.
Oh, wow.
It's complicated, but, you know, those are important things. When my mother-in-law came to visit us before the IRONMAN, she literally brought an entire, like, giant suitcase of research, which then we could make for probably the next year, and even a bike rack. She put a bike rack in a suitcase. It happened. Yeah.
So, I wouldn't think that case of in another country would be that big of a deal.
It is. I mean, for people traveling in races, no big deal. But when you live down here, I mean, either you don't have to buy a garden down here, it's just going to cost me probably 40% more.
Really?
Yeah. Definitely. So it's all these are the kind of things that you want, but you're going to pay a lot more for them. So it's like, I'll wait till I go home.
But it really is that big of a deal because, I mean, if you guys just, if you get it on Amazon, you get it on Amazon. And if Amazon,
no Amazon.
No Amazon.
No.
So, do you have like a local body shop you shop with?
I think it's like tubes or tire levers, you know, CO2 cartridges. Yeah, I'm going to a local bike shop, but most people here ride mountain bikes. Being on the road, like that's just, you don't see a ton of road bikes. You definitely don't see many tri bikes except for the like small little triathlon community. And I guess it's probably much different, but yeah, choices are limited.
Yeah, I take everything so for granted, I guess.
Yeah.
Probably an hour, and probably within an hour, in any direction, has like 5 or 6 bike shops. I would have something that I need.
Oh, it makes me so jealous.
This is like a good time here.
As soon as this money went over, so I'm just like, oh, all the great things. My husband was like, on this last trip home, I bought another bike seat. He just, I paid in cash, so he didn't rent it until he saw it on the bike. And he was like, what? I bought another bike seat. I'm like,
which one did you get?
I got the Specialized Power Expert with Mimic. I rode it once, but I'm really bad at that whole. I think they on race day. I rode it once before the race and then switched back to my Specialized Sagero Pro before the race. I wasn't blown away by it. But my position on my cervello is super aggressive. I think it's my cervello. Yeah, it's a really aggressive position. So I don't know, I feel like that
bike seat
might find its place on my road bike.
Have you tried
like
the last
step
yet?
Oh, is it like the problem? Like,
yeah.
Well, yeah, that came on the cervello. It's too wide for me. I think we can get the earlier version, but I really want to try it at some point. I've been having issues with. I like the Sagero Pro, but I've been getting really bad saddle sores. It's just like, I don't know if I'm ever going to be actually comfortable.
Okay.
Maybe.
Yeah, so you get it down to the next big hour check in. 50 and 50 in. No, this is a transition race. Did you ever both transition? Is it going to slow everything down or did you
want to do it? Yeah, so. So, yeah, we, Saturday morning I went to the expo, got checked in, and I had my whole, like, I have a transition bag, you know, like a backpack, and as I'm So I wasn't thinking. I was just like, I don't know how to get my bag in when I transition. I gotta go to the other transition and do all that stuff.
You're not wearing like short socks either. You're wearing floor socks.
Yeah. I like them because they look pretty. Argentina, I had a blister literally on every toe, and I got a couple of those, I don't know how you say it, engine toe socks. I raced in those to see if that helped my blister issue, but I just, you know, maybe I just do it for the gram, you know, nice toe socks, because it just looks clean and fresh. Yeah, so I was kind of haphazardly putting my transition together. I normally didn't think about it a lot. I thought about it a lot leading up to that point and had everything in my backpack ready to go. But for some reason, I was just not thinking about the stock thing. So last time I checked in, they didn't have any of my information somehow. And then I didn't have a bib. So I put my race belt in my bag. They're like, they're gonna put your race number or your bib on your belt tonight. And I was like, okay, all right. Okay, let's just, you know, let's move on. Next transition, drop off the bike, you know, not everything settled later. They handwrote my stickers for the bike and helmet and everything like that, but they didn't have the bib in the run bib, so I didn't know what my number was. They must have had some sort of technical issue because my friend had like two registrations I had from. But anyway, you know, it's just kind of one of those things where I'm still going to race tomorrow. So I went to the second train, my first transition at the Xiao Xiao Hotel. And, put my bike down, made sure everything was in the bag that I needed. Except for, I didn't put my torpedo bottle on the bike or the other bottle that I was going to carry. I got all that settled and then checked out, the swim in, swim out, bike in, bike out. It was quite a bit of a hill from the transition up out onto the bike course. So it was good that I looked at that the night before because then, I put my bike in the right gear. It's always something to remember. Check out your, make sure you know where you're going when you get out of transition, because, if you normally leave your shoes on your bike, like I do, this was not the race for that.
Now, I know it's like really pretty there, but this transition is quite long, too.
Yes.
It's not like you can have a bike and help others have a transition and you're getting on the bike. You have to hold your bike or run with your bike.
Yes, the good part about this was that it was on the side of a golf course, so most of it was like grass rather than, gravel or asphalt. I mean, running in shoes on asphalt is like the worst thing in the world. So it wasn't too bad.
That's good. So after you get your bike and all that stuff settled, I already know that the water temperature is going to be cold. Have they predicted how cold it's going to be? Have you asked around about that?
I didn't want to ask. I'm kind of weaning out the cold. I'm a Texan born and raised, and I just don't do great with cold. So going in, I bought a neoprene sweat cap.
coach Bill later.
So everyone in Argentina has a very heavy Italian influence, so you can get pasta wherever you go. You can get potatoes, bananas, like all the carbs, you know, bread.
That's good. Are you a carb girl?
Oh, yes. So I actually knew nutrition the night before the race was abysmal. Or was it 2 days before? Yeah, it was the right day before the race. I didn't eat breakfast before going to do a light track of my check-in and transition, so it wasn't. I didn't eat lunch until about like 3 p.m.
Lunch? Great.
Yeah, poor planning on my part. So I had basically like a ravioli, but a different name. There's like, there's like a lot of different like ravioli types. You know, like, Sorrentinos, and like, I have all these other names. So I had like basically a ravioli for lunch with some like cream sauce and mayonnaise and protein and some carbs right there. And dinner, we actually had sushi. So I got me, and I got an extra side of white rice. And some raw fish. I was a little nervous about that one, I think. But I had some friends in town with us. I didn't want to make it like, oh, I have to have pasta, I have to have pizza tonight. And so I was just like, yeah, you can just tell me where you want to go, and I'll figure out what I can eat there. So, we can eat sushi.
It's not even classic sushi, though.
Oh, God.
The day of the race, there's a gift of sushi. The day of the race tomorrow.
It is a nice little place, but Argentine seemed very late. Since we had such a late lunch, we had a late dinner. And I ordered a roll of avocado. I ordered a roll that did not say avocado on it. And it came with avocado on it. I almost cried. I was like, I just waited an hour for this food. And it has avocado in it. What am I going to do? Anyway, they made the roll like, with haste. So I was able to like, get all my food in and probably in bed by 11:30.
In bed at 11:30 for the rice?
Yes. This race didn't start until 10 a.m. So, yeah. So yeah, I was like, got to sleep in a little bit.
Why is it going there?
The temperature.
Really?
Last year, I think they originally planned to start, you know, 7 or 8. And they had much worse conditions last year. It was like raining and super, super cold. Just like a horrible day. So I think last minute last year, they pushed the start time. This year, they knew, like, we just got to start later. Because until the sun is up and like warms everything up, it's miserable. Until June, when I woke up, it was like 45 degrees.
Yeah. Now, I don't know if you know this or not, but in Monday, which is tomorrow, whatever it is, just as that much, it's actually hot again, like in Mexico.
That sounds hot.
Very hot. Like last year, it was very hot. It's a great question for the powers that
be. It also seems weird because with road closures and all of that, I feel like I like to do races earlier because that's when people aren't driving as much.
I mean, that's okay. I know a few pros are doing a race and an age over two. I'm like, hey, I know that those are selling them, right? And I'm like, no. Like, yeah, sun's turning up. You have to sleep in. So you're going to be at like 11, and you wake up on a race day. What time do you get up, and what's your race day morning ritual like before you head down to the venue?
So I woke up probably about 6 a.m. To watch the sunrise over the lake Nowelbopi, and that was beautiful. I had oatmeal and just slathered it with honey, and I had instant coffee. That was really awful tasting. I didn't even put sugar or almond milk in it. I was just like, you know, I just gotta get this down, get things moving, get a little Friends Hotel, which was kind of close to the restart, and we went there together. So a couple things on that. It was difficult to get to and from each transition. Team 1 was at the Shasha Hotel, and then there's probably, you know, 30 kilometers, something like that, in between that and T2. And we shut down the road, so we couldn't, they didn't let me pass to get to a race start. I was like, what? Like, no, I'm racing. Like, look at me, I'm racing. Like, let me through. So, you know, I just kind of had to get out of risky palms and get through the blockheads. We also got stopped by the police that morning. It's just like, here in Argentina, they just have all these police stuff. They just got it slow, and they, like, you know, kind of gesture at you to pull over, and they check to make sure you have insurance, and, basically registration. And I was going to forgot on his driver's license. This cop was like, I can detain you right now for driving without a license. I was like, kind of translating for him. I'm like, please don't. I'm just going to keep staying on these other pages. I want to get to this race. And she finally, after like explaining that, you know, if he gets stopped again, it'll detain him until someone else can bring his driver's license. I'm just like, this is literally the worst start to race morning. Just like totally, you know, bringing my nerves up. You know, all I was trying to do is stay calm.
So you finally get down there after all this hustle and bustle. What's the atmosphere like in transition?
It was great and fun, and everyone, like, people didn't seem that nervous. They're just kind of like, hey, let's like go do this thing today. I had to go over to the Shimano tent to get my tires to look there. I got that done, and I heard people speaking English, which, you know, living down here, I don't hear very often. And I was like, hey, I'm like, we're from Boston. And I was like, what? I'm from Texas, too. So, you know, like, kind of had this camaraderie with all these Texans, and there were a few people from, like, California, too. And I was just shocked that they made the trip down here. I hung out with my grandma, and we just kind of got prepped for a race. But we had half a red spot at that point. We dropped off our street bags and then headed down to the water.
Nice. So, how much base on did you use this course?
100. I pretty much always do 100.
Okay. So, you're definitely using a wetsuit here. What kind of kit are you using?
So, I went super had a pair of distorted tri shorts on. They have like nearly any kind of thing, basically like a fleece chamois. And then my sports bra. I decided to do that outside in a private bathroom because it was cold there as well. And I just knew I was going to want dry clothes for the bike. You know, with the cold air temperature is great when you're just running, but when you're wet and getting on a bike, it's not so great. So, my plan was to change into tri shorts and then a tri top after the swim. So that's what I'm wearing in my wetsuit.
Because people that simply live in the States might not realize that in other countries they actually have changing tents for the 7.3 distance.
Yeah, I had some friends that were like, "Why are you going to change?" And I was like, "Yeah." In any other situation, if it was normal, like better conditions or just warmer conditions, I would just say, "Okay." Either a one-piece tri kit or a dry suit or a two-piece tri kit.
Well, you know, because that's how I do it. I mean, when I get off so much here, it was freezing.
I volunteered there.
Oh my goodness, it was cold.
Oh my god, I hope you didn't blow up someone like that. So
like,
it was for my teammates that were racing. You couldn't even have a helmet, and I was sort of transitions because I would have, as a volunteer, I could have helped them get them off. And I know I heard a lot of the pros at that race couldn't get their helmets off.
Yeah, like, they couldn't get their helmets off. They couldn't get their shoes. Like, it was cold. Like, my hands were freezing. Like, it was tough.
Oh, God. That's okay. The cold, I had so many thoughts that were, like, getting ready for the race. I'm just like, I don't know if I can do this. It's going to be so cold. Like, I don't want to be a quitter. But I also don't want to die. Or maybe not die, but can have to party up. That's like an actual possibility.
Yes, but now, what was your mindset going into those races? Did you actually want to PR? Did you want to do your best? Did you want to just go out and have fun? What was this like?
That race, my goal is to finish. After this first run, I don't like to put a lot of pressure on myself because then I feel like it kills the fun a little bit for me. I know everyone's different, but for me, it's just like, I just want to finish. And then there's always that, like, I have like three different goals. It's like, okay, I want to finish. And my second goal is, okay, well, if I can actually finish, then maybe PR, and then maybe podium. You know, it's like, just kind of like, keep those goals in mind, and don't let your happiness basically like get attached to those goals. It's just like, I do this because it's fun, and triathletes are really great to meet around. Everyone's super positive. Yeah, just like
that atmosphere. So, after you get your bike and all that fun stuff done, you get your wetsuit all the way on, down there by the start line. What's the atmosphere like in the starting crowd?
It was a small field this year, and everyone was just, everyone looked pretty concerned about the water temperature. If they did, I missed it. But I'm a giant Kathy, so I probably was talking when they announced it.
So you missed the water temperature, so you didn't really know how cold it was going to be?
No. And, the day before I did do a test swim, they don't let you right there at the end. And I had an extended moment. You got it. I was supposed to do a test swim. I knew it was going to be cold. I actually got it. Strangely enough, scuba diving in that lake probably 11 months before. And then it was 13 degrees Celsius. It was 15 degrees Celsius on that on race day, so it was 13 when I went scuba diving. It was about 7 mil wetsuit scuba diving with gloves and booties. Of course, I'm not swimming, or just kind of sitting on the bottom of the lake, but I just had this mental thing going on where I'm like, I am quite freeze to death. I just freeze up and not be able to swim, right? Or, like when your face hits the water and it's just like a.
Totally. Is that what happened to you when we had the water?
Only for a split second, and then it was like, I just started moving. I didn't really feel my face until I really got warmed up. I didn't really do much of a warm up before this one. Other than kind of like dancing in place and running around transition.
Dancing in place?
Yeah, that's really dancing. We turned on the kind of band, like the army band or something, was playing YMCA. And no one even knows the YMCA, but they were playing it. So I was like, actually doing the moves, and like, what is that? It's like a sports club. Like, explaining it to one of my friends, it's literally like a gym. I guess what I'm about.
Yeah, that's
great. I gave you a little more context, but.
I was like, one of the band practitioners.
Yeah.
Because I can't see without seeing it, and you can get a placement in construction worker.
God.
So, you get the swing up. This is a two-turn swim. You would just go out, turn, and come right back.
Actually, they changed it.
Oh, so it's not like it's on the
remember this morning they made an announcement that they were going to shorten the course and then make it a 2-lap. Because there was a lot of wind. We were kind of in like a little bay in this lake. And the further we got out from this bay, I don't know where it was, and I guess the buoys didn't stay in place. The lakes are also very deep, you know, further out into the middle that you go. So it's probably hard to keep those buoys moving. So they made it, and I wasn't really sure when they were explaining it. I wasn't really sure exactly how that the 2-lap was going to look, but of course the pros went off 20 minutes before, so we were able to see what they were doing. I was like, okay, it was actually probably for the best.
Okay, so you can you do what you get out of line and get right back in. So yes. You get a little bit of warm air and then you get right back in the cold water.
Initial, like, take your breath away, this is really cold. But I started moving, and then at one point, I don't know how, but I just got a whole gulp of water and kind of choked on it. Had to take a second to like catch my breath. I'm like, right, really coughing under, you know, with my face in the water, but I was like, oh, wait, let me catch my breath a sec. And I kept moving, and the water is so clear, I could see to the bottom of the lake. Oh, yeah. Like, I'm not even exaggerating. I could see the bottom of the lake until it got super, super deep. But yeah, it was gorgeous. So yeah, I was just kind of focused on, just like keeping it nice and smooth. I am alternating breathing, and most of the time I'm every 3 strokes, bilateral breathing. Occasionally I'll breathe more to the right hand side, to this side with the buoys. The water was mostly pretty calm, which is great. Like I said, the further you went out, it got a little bit wavier, but nothing compared to an ocean swell. I love lakes.
You had to see the anchors that held the buoys in place in the bottom.
I was almost sliding off of those. I was actually ran into a buoy because the buoy was being pushed in, the line was kind of diagonal, and I'm looking at the line, and the buoy is like right in front of me.
So, were you having to sign into that stuff at all the way back in?
Oh, my God, it actually wasn't too bad. I can see the buoys pretty clearly. It wasn't too bad because the sun was coming up over the hill. So, yeah, it was like right into your face.
That's good. So, you get out of the swim. There's a little bit of sand right out of the swim before you get that transition.
Like I said, it was like on a golf course. So, it had really nice, with the green grass and all the thorns in it. So you can easily run it and not worry about destroying your little bare feet. I had my wetsuit stripped off and had a garment. I had a garment in Phoenix 3. And I have to take it off to get my wetsuit off, which is quite annoying. Because my wetsuit is still tied on my wrist, nice good seal on it. I don't think I took it off this time. The wetsuit stripper's like tearing up my sleeve. I got my wetsuit on. Ran, got my bag, went to the change tent. Actually, I had a quicker transition than I was anticipating. Getting dry clothes on when you're soaking wet is not easy. I know a lot of people don't change for half Ironmans or even Ironmans, but it's hard. It's almost not even worth it. But I just, again, I'm weaning off the cold, and I didn't want any cold on the bike, so I said, put on my dry shorts, socks, arrow top, put on a vest, and gloves, too, for good measure. Everything on the vest, it has this huge pocket in the back. It's like a cycling vest. So I think I just threw all my nutrition in that bag, and made that little trek up to the mountain line. which goes to the national forest there in Bariloche, and it's gorgeous. Look at the hills, but it's beautiful.
So it gets like a little bit of time.
Yeah, exactly. It's huge, ancient trees, and when you get to the top of the hill, you know, when you're like dying at the top of the hill, and you see these beautiful vistas of the lake down below. So it's great to think about those things, but at the same time, you know, you're totally out of breath. Wish I had a few more gears. But, you know, it's like a friend of mine offered to put on a few bigger the three together, just like the end one. And I was like, no, I'm all good. Like, oh man, I should have taken one of them.
Okay, so how many steps are you doing? Are you saying, no, I'm good, we'll do whatever you want different for another? You get a sushi. No, you do whatever you want, and you get some coffee. No, you do whatever you want, and you get the same tip. Maybe you should start trying to be a little bit more assertive. And what you actually want to say, well, tell me more about that. That might be interesting.
Maybe I'll take you up on that. Maybe I should be a little more assertive on the side. I'm just going to go with the flow kind of person. For the most part, you know, there's definitely things where I'm like, you know, it has to be my way. Usually, you know, if it's just me and my husband, it would have been, no, I'm getting what I want. So the first part of the bike, it was hard, and I had ridden that part of the course before, probably about a year ago, on a mountain bike with a lot more gear, more weight, but also more options with my cassette, you know, bigger gears and all that. So, I kind of knew what to expect for parts. On the downhills, you know, you think, oh, downhill's great. This is going to be awesome. It was scary. And this was a race where, you know, I think disc brakes are, they're great for, like, off-roading. And if you're going on, like, really hilly courses or rides, but for triathlon, for the most part, my personal opinion is that it's just an extra. You know, you don't need it. This was a race where I was like, God, I wish I had disc brakes. I'm a little sketched out. Because the hills were so steep, but then you have a little break in the trees and the wind kind of the side and like push you. But you know, I'm pretty light. And I had some pedal weights on my cervello. But so if it catches on my on the cervello. That's not her bike. the wind really caught me from the side, and I spent a lot more time than I usually do on the outside bars rather than down in the aero bars. Luckily, with this bike, I have, I will speak in Spanish words, cambios, letters, shifters. Shifters on the outside bars too.
Is it like time shifting?
Yes, yeah, too. So that's a really nice thing to have because I spent a lot more time on those bars than in my other bars. So after a little while, my bar tape on the left side started coming off, and I was just like, all right, this is great. And I kept trying to like move the tape around and stick, but I took it off and stuck it in my pocket. So I did stop. There was a Shimano tent on the course, and I stopped. I was like, do you have tape? And he was like, yes. And he like taped my bar tape real quick. But what I didn't know is he taped over my shifter on that side. Not in the world, you know, I stole my shift from the aero bars, but it was like, shift. I'm going to stop again, though, you know? Not great. You shut off the whole road. It's specialist than being the road, the main road. They shut off all traffic you stayed close to the yellow line, the road was okay. You know, where the cars drive, not as great. Huge puddles that just, you know, kind of go crumbling or cracking. But they definitely do the best they can to mark out the big stuff. You definitely have to keep your eyes open, especially in the shade. You know, it can be harder to see those things. I personally didn't have any issues, though.
Was this like chip seal? Or is
it mostly? Most of the course was asphalt. I think. Yeah, part of it was like concrete. But this is a super fun ski town. So they get ice and snow and all that stuff. So it is going to tear up the roads a little bit.
Right. So what about the aid stations? Were they stopped for what you needed?
Yeah.
You know, for about 3.5 hours, and did you have everything that you needed the whole time?
Yeah, so, I had my torpedo, and then I had another bottle on my frame that was basically concentrating tailwind so that I could squeeze that into my torpedo and then grab a water from a aid station and fill it up the rest of the way. The aid stations had this really great, they use power rate, so for North Americans, you know, if you're driving down the Nevis race, you can have power rate by the right. And local gels. Iron gel. I personally haven't tried them because, you know, I'm used to it too, and I'm going to stick with that. But, yeah, the aid stations were really well stocked. You know, they have Powerade water, usually fruit and gel. And
are they on the right side of the road or the right side of the road?
The right side.
Okay. Yeah, and only on the right side of the road down there too.
Yes.
Okay.
And no, that right side of the road. So that, you know, that's pretty typical. They have them, these Powerade bottles. They're kind of like, you know, those big green Powerade bottles. They're perfect. And actually, I didn't take them and keep them all in the kit, but they do stay in your, your cages, yeah.
So did you have a specific plan of how you want to execute the bike ride from a power or heart rate or cadence standpoint? What's this like?
So I don't have power on the bike. I train with power when I'm on Swift, but other than that, I haven't invested in a power meter for my bike yet. But you know, willing to accept sponsors for that. I just wanted to look a little bit, just keep an eye on my heart rate, keep it under probably about 160, maybe lower if I can. I went mostly by feel though, just like thinking, okay, you know, I still have to do a half marathon after all of this climbing. I tried to stay in the saddle, you know, for the climbs as much as I could, maybe a little bit out of the saddle, just to give my, you know, all the undercarriage won't break. So you get a saddle for 3.5 hours and just always starts to hurt.
Yes.
But about midway, I stuck to my nutrition plan until probably about midway through the bike. You know, drinking tailwind, I probably ate a honey stinger waffle, some cliff blocks. And then my stomach just cranked up like it never has before. And I just started burping, like, really obscenely. Really loud, like, everything stopped. And I kind of felt like maybe my kid was digging in into my stomach and making me uncomfortable, plus, like, aggressive. My aggressive position, sorry. I just thought, like, maybe it's just all of those things combined. But I started having trouble getting my nutrition, and I kept going with the tailwind. And I was thirsty, but I just, I couldn't do the rest of my blocks. I couldn't get in, you know, last few. I just wasn't having it this time. Thanks. expectations. You know, tossing at least one cup of water on my head.
Sure.
plenty of shade on most of the course. You know, these big old, ash trees, you know, kind of like oak-like trees, giving some shade, as well as, you know, get some shade from the buildings.
So, for the run, did you have a pace that you went ahead, or are you going off a heart rate still for the bike? What was this like?
I would love to hit, like, 9:30 pace. Discount in last year.
So, looking back on it, how was the recovery process? Are you completely recovered now?
Yes. I was in a really good recovery. We're staying at Airbnb, and our host was nice enough to stay. I asked her if we could check out late because I didn't finish until 5 or 6 in the afternoon. And then we paid in for rooms at 7 p.m. And I still had to shower, and we were driving home that night. So, after we got into the wards, I'll come back for Airbnb, shower, pack everything as quickly as possible, including the dogs, and get the room for 5 hours because we had to work on one day. So we didn't get home until 2 a.m.
Oh, my goodness.
And 5 hours in a car after racing is never fun.
I've been there 3 years in a row with Dallas, and so I went to Dallas, and so if you're racing, shower, get back home. It's
rough.
So, was this your first time on the podium?
I'm in a random race, yes.
Wow. What was it like?
It was cool. It was short-lived. it was just like, okay, go here, stand on the podium, hold your board at it, get my ass off. No one said that. It felt somewhat uncomfortable for me. It was kind of like, that was cool. It was a great feeling to podium in the Ironman, but I felt like I'm cheating because there's only 4 people in my age group. I didn't feel like I fought for it. It kind of felt like you weren't DFL, so.
No,
I was going to wait and see. My husband was itching to get on the road, so I went and actually found the girl that was first place. There was only one slot given for my age group, and I went and asked her if she was going to Nice, and she said yes. And I was like, cool, I don't have to wait. What's at the road?
Wow.
I think it would be really cool just to, snag a slot to Nice, but yeah, there's always other opportunities.
Yes.
And who knows, maybe the next year will be in an even cooler place.
New Zealand.
Oh.
Yes, it's New Zealand.
Those might be goals.
Yes. So, what's some of the things we learned from this race experience that you don't have to pass on to someone who hasn't done this race before?
So I would say a couple of things. One, study your athlete guide and take a good look at the course. Like I said, this is a hilly race, but the more you kind of get that into your head and practice for those hills, the better off you're going to be. The other is to just kind of prepare any and every type of cold weather gear that you might need. You can always put more gear in your transition bags than you actually anticipate using. It's better to have it in there and not need it. And you didn't have that, especially for the bike. If you want to put on dry clothes for the bike and then have arm warmers or a vest or whatever else you can do to make yourself more comfortable on the bike, that will really set you up for a better race.
I know we didn't really talk about this much, but transition or changing to rather, is it like dirt or is it mud? Was it grass, gravel? What was that like?
So the changing tent was on grass. This is definitely way better than being in sand, in my opinion. I got a little bit of grass on the inside of my kit, but so much better than putting sand into it. The two tents just right next to each other, one big open tent with chairs around the edges, and plenty of space. Girls, not many guys too, but definitely girls helping each other out in there.
Okay. So if you you could change anything about this race, what would you change and why?
I don't think the horse or how I raced.
The race that you need to race the horse itself. What's the layout or functionality?
I would have much preferred one transition as opposed to two separate transitions. Although, this thing, you know, I think is problematic for that. It was just hard for spectators to watch both the swim in T1 as well as T2 and in the run. Because they showed off the main road to and from the center of town and the stem start. So that would probably be what I would change. I know some spectators, like my friend who was watching her husband, was able to watch both, but my husband was only able to see T2 and the run.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
So if our first timers are doing this race next year, what advice would you give them? Especially if they're coming from the States.
I should be a little bit Spanish. You're not only volunteers that speak some English, but I think that can be helpful. I mean, you do a great job of translating a lot of stuff. That would be helpful.
What should somebody learn in Spanish? Like, if you see a brush up on this movie, what do you mean?
The basic water, thank you. Anything that you would call out for an enemy station, for example, water, for power, you can just say power. Different travel location. Little things like that. It's just nice to be able to communicate, especially when you're trying to get to an aid station quickly.
Okay. And I'm sure, bathroom or whatever, public is not nice.
Yes. But Google Translate is a great asset to have. So, if you're coming to Argentina, just be prepared for things to be very different from what you're used to. It's very foreign to the US, and there are a lot of things that are different here.
A lot of things.
Yeah, I think foods and customs, like eating at a lot of restaurants. The English might be different because it's more touristy, but a lot of restaurants won't even open until 8:30. So if you're coming from the States and you're just eating at 6:30, 7, maybe have a plan, maybe do an Airbnb or a cabin and cook your own meals. That way, you can get the kind of foods you're used to before racing. Like I said, if you're used to eating, like carbo loading on pasta and bread, you're definitely going to find that here.
Wow. So, logistically, complicated. Was this really complicated of a race to do, or was this pretty easy?
I mean, the course was difficult. So, it was definitely not an easy course. But in terms of the depth of the field, it could be the risk that you could get a slot to New Zealand for World Championships.
Okay. So what's next for you?
I'm not really sure. I'm really twiddling my thumbs trying to figure out what's next. I think I really want to do Pocon in Chile in January. I have a bunch of friends that are doing that race, and I'd like to do it as well. It's also, like a 7-hour drive from here. So again, where I go, the dogs will go to. We can drive there. But I hear it's just gorgeous. Other than that, I'm not sure. I'd like to get in probably another half. The tri-season is kind of over a year, so if I do another half this year, I would probably have to come back to the States. I'm not sure. Maybe a trail race, anywhere from like a half marathon to 50K. I'd like to get something like that since I'm kind of going into running season now. Although running is my least it's kind of easy to train for you, like, especially if you're traveling, just bring a pair of running shoes and you're all set to go.
Yeah, it's super easy. So, what are you going to go for this year?
Thanks for tuning in today. I hope you were able to learn something from today's episode. If you enjoy the show, please take a minute to leave a review on iTunes or share it with a friend. Be sure to subscribe so you never miss an episode. If you'd like to see pictures from this athlete's race, learn more about who I am, what I'm doing, or be on the show yourself to share your story, check out my website at CoachTerryWilson.com. Until next time, continue the pursuit.